Hi, I'm Ted Bible, pastor at St. Mark's Methodist Church, and thank you for joining me today. As we are continuing our year-long journey through the New Testament book of Mark. But before we get to the study today, I want to once again invite you to share any prayer concerns, joys or concerns with us. You may share those by emailing those requests to us at limastmarks@gmail.com. limastmarks@gmail.com, and we'd be happy to join you in prayer. Additionally, if you live in the Lima area and you do not have a church home, we would love for you to come and visit us some Sunday morning. We worship at 10:15, and we are located at 1110 North Metcalf Street here in Lima. Well, as I said, we are continuing our year-long study of the Gospel of Mark, and today we are in chapter 12, and we're going to be reading and studying verses 28 through 34. And so Mark writes, "One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, 'Of all the commandments, which is the most important?' 'The most important one,' Jesus said, 'is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, and with all your soul, and with all of your mind, and with all of your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these.' 'Well said, teacher,' the man replied. 'You are right in saying that God is one and there is no other but him. To love him with all your heart, with all your understanding, and with all your strength, and to love your neighbor as yourself is more important than all burnt offerings and sacrifices.' When Jesus saw that he had answered wisely, he said to him, 'You are not far from the kingdom of God.' And from then on, no one dared ask him any more questions." So our reading today begins with one of the teachers of the law, that being a lawyer, came and heard them debating. And noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked them, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" Although other religious leaders had been unsuccessfully trying to trick Jesus, Mark presents this lawyer to us as someone who is sincerely and respectfully seeking an answer from Jesus. You see, the Pharisees were a religious group that had identified 613 laws or commands from God. And they were so obsessed with obeying their interpretation of these laws that they completely overlooked or they ignored God's message of mercy and his message of grace. Additionally, the Pharisees thought that all 613 laws were of equal importance, which now puts this question asked of Jesus into its proper context. So the lawyer asked Jesus to identify the most important or the greatest commandment in the law. And Jesus answered him by quoting from what we know as the Old Testament and the tradition that the Pharisees and all Jews, for that matter, knew and respected. And Jesus said, "The most important one is this: Hear, O Israel, the Lord your God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all of your heart, with all of your soul, and with all of your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this: love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." Jesus' reply comes from Deuteronomy chapter 6 and from Leviticus chapter 19. And these were laws that had been handed down from Moses to the Pharisees. You see, if we love God with the entirety of our being and our neighbor as ourselves, then we will not lie, we will not murder, we will not steal, we will not commit adultery, we will not get involved in gossiping about people, we will not seek revenge or hold a grudge against others or physically or verbally abuse anyone. We will, however, feed the hungry, provide water for the thirsty, care for the sick and those in prison, Provide shelter for the homeless and be concerned about the general welfare of all people. So we should love God as God loves, because real love comes from God and real love requires action. Let me repeat that. We should love as God loves, because real love comes from God and real love requires action. The New Testament book of 1 John is a letter written to the church by Jesus' disciple, John. And in chapter 4, verses 7 through 12, we read these words. Dear friends, let us love one another, for love comes from God. Everyone who loves has been born of God and knows God. Whoever does not love does not know God, because God is love. This is how God showed his love among us. He sent his one and only Son into the world that we might live through him. This is love. Not that we loved God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as an atoning sacrifice for our sins. Dear friends, since God so loved us, John writes, we also ought to love one another. No one has ever seen God, but if we love one another, God lives in us and his love is made complete in us. Just think for a moment about the hate crimes that have occurred and that are occurring in this world today. From Adolf Hitler to radical Islamic terrorist groups to hate crimes in our own country. These individuals have not been born of God, nor do they know God, because they do not love. Well, what about the drug dealers and those involved in human slave trafficking, or those who distribute child pornography? These people have not been born of God, nor do they know God, because they do not love. It's really sad, isn't it? Now, not everyone who doesn't know God acts like this, but clearly these are examples of people who don't love God and who don't love their neighbor. Most everyone believes that love is important, but love is usually thought of as a feeling. Love is more than just a feeling. Love is a choice, and love is an action. The Apostle Paul provides for us a good description of what love is, as recorded in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verses 4 through 7, which is a letter that he wrote to the Corinthian church. You know these verses because you've likely heard them recited at a wedding. And it goes like this. Love is patient. Love is kind. It does not envy. It does not boast. It is not proud. It does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking. It is not easily angered. It keeps no record of wrongs. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices with the truth. It always protects. It always trusts. It always hopes, and it always perseveres. God is the source of this type of love. God's love is love in action. The world, on the other hand, thinks that love is what makes a person feel good, and that it's all right to sacrifice moral principles and the rights of other people in order to obtain such love or such a loving feeling. But that isn't an example of God's love. No, love that is just based on feelings is love based on selfishness. And selfishness is far from who God is. God's love was displayed to the world when God took action and chose to sacrifice his Son for us. When God chose to send his Son to earth to die as an atoning sacrifice for the sins of all of humanity, that was a sign of God's love. It was far more than just a feeling. As we have learned in our journey through our readings of Mark, when Jesus chose to heal people of their illnesses and restore sight to the blind and to heal the paralyzed, he did this out of love. It wasn't love as a feeling. It was love in action. When Jesus brought the dead back to life, and when he fed over 5,000 people with 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, it wasn't love as a feeling, but it was love in action. When Jesus will choose to not resist his arrest and to willingly accept his verdict to die on the cross, that will not be love as a feeling, but it will be love in action. When Jesus charges his disciples to go to all the nations and to make disciples, saving people from an eternity in hell and giving them an eternity in heaven, this will not be love as a feeling, but rather it will be love in action. So how can we love like God? How can our love be love in action? The Holy Spirit gives us the power to love like God, to put our love into action. When we accept Jesus as our personal Savior, the Holy Spirit will come and live in our hearts and make us more and more and more like Jesus Christ. Loving our neighbors ourselves involves action. Now, to clarify who our neighbors are, Jesus told a story that we know as the Good Samaritan. A Jew was traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho, and he is beaten, and he is robbed. Another Jew, a priest, passes him by and doesn't stop to help. And still another, a Levite, a religious leader, also passes him by, and he does not stop to help. Of all the religious leaders, these two classes should have known what was most important, and that helping people was a priority. But neither of them stopped to help. Then along came a Samaritan. Now, Samaritans were hated by the Jews because of their racial makeup and their religious beliefs. So Jesus picks the most extreme example that he can find as someone that no self-respecting Jewish man would be associated with. The Samaritan violates purity laws by taking action. And as a result, he is soiled by the blood of the victim, and he puts him on his own animal. He finds help and nursing care for the victim. He makes sure that he is well taken care of. He leaves money to pay for the medical expenses, and he promises to make up whatever additional expenses there are when he returns back through that way. And then Jesus asked those who heard the story, who was the neighbor to the man who was robbed and who was beaten? Not even being able to mention the Samaritan's nationality. The answer that came back from the religious rulers for whom Jesus told this story was the one who showed mercy to him. With that story, Jesus radically changed the meaning and the boundaries of neighbor. Neighbor now meant a wider group than just Jews. Neighbor now meant those whom we were sure were destined for destruction and for hell. Neighbor now meant people who were not our equals, people not even worthy to be in our company. And loving our neighbor even meant putting ourselves at risk, giving up our own schedules, our own resources, our time, our energy, our reputation, and taking not just immediate responsibility, but long-term responsibility. Long-term responsibility for our neighbor. It meant, as Jesus would later say, laying down your life for your friend. Here's the takeaway from the message today. How well do you display your love for God in the choices you make and in the actions that you take? What action are you going to take to love the Lord with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and with all your strength? What action are you going to take that will show that you love your neighbor just as much as you love yourself? Let us pray. Father God, we know that our love is weak and cold in comparison to your love. Lord, we want to love you more and more with every facet of our lives, in our thoughts, in our words, and in our actions. Pour into our hearts your holy love that we may be used as a channel of blessing and encouragement to those that we meet every day. This is our prayer today in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, thank you once again for joining me today, and thank you for your prayer support as well as your financial support of the ministries here at St. Mark's. If you would like to support us financially, you may do so by mailing your gift to St. Mark's Methodist Church, 1110 North Metcalf Street, Lima, Ohio, 45801. Until next time, I pray God's blessing be upon you, and I pray that you will love your neighbor as yourself.